Hi there, my name is Tom McIntyre. I'm the deputy director at the Brademas Center at NYU. It's been a privilege working on this project with Renato and Mauro and all of our program sponsors. Just some housekeeping rules. If you have any questions throughout the course of the sessions, please use the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. We also have translation available from English to Italian and Italian to English. Also, you'll find buttons at the bottom of the screen if you need to utilize that function. Other than that, thank you for being here, and I hope you enjoy the program.
Thank you, Thomas. Thank you. And good morning or good afternoon. I don't know. We are in two sides of the ocean. I am in Washington, D.C. I'm Renato Miracco, our curator, critic. And Mauro is on the other side of the ocean. Let me give you a little bit of background of this event. 1 year, 1 year and a half ago, I was curating an advisor for an exhibition about immigration. And Mauro, in his job, was working on immigration issue as well. And we had a long conversation and breakfast and lunch talking about immigration. So I say, why don't we create an event just with a new perspective, a new point of view? And we humbly today really would like just to propose to you this new idea. We decide just to divide the event into two sections, one section with documentary, really famous one documentary, and a beautiful documentary as well. And from the other side, we would like just to explore a new path, how immigration can inspire people creating art. So in the first part, we explore photography, music, dance, and then we have the documentary. I hope you will really enjoy. And I would like just to say thank you to NYU Washington, D.C., ICS Washington, D.C., University of Palermo, Department of Law, and Multivolti, who will host just the Q&A at the end. Thank you. And Mauro, I leave the floor to you.
Thank you, Renato, and thanks everybody for connecting today. We're very excited to have the opportunity to present this program to you. And as Renato said, this is really the result of different conversations that we had, but also conversation with a lot of wonderful people who really share with us their art, but also their work. So we have been talking with people who have experienced the journey, and they've been able to transform this experience into a creative process leading to some of the results we're going to showcase today. But also we've been talking with people who have really put their time and effort to make sure that the voice of people of the move is heard. And what we really feel is that there are people with different expertise ranging from art, economics, activism, and academia who focus on the issue of migration, but sometimes there are some silos. So we work in silos that today we would like to break and put everyone on the table and try to discuss about a common approach and common solution. Migration is a complex issue. And so we really believe that only by bringing everyone together, we would be able to find solutions. I would like to join Renato's thank you to the NYU DC, to the University of Palermo Department of Law, to the Italian Cultural Society in Washington, D.C., and to Multivolti. Thanks to them, this event has been possible. And also special thanks to Tom for all his hard work throughout the preparation of this event. And of course, my personal thanks to Renato for all his passion and efforts put in this event and for being very patient as we had several discussions on this. So I'll pass the stage back to you, Renato, and I hope everyone will enjoy this event. Thank you.
Thank you, Mauro, really. Thank you. As you said, immigration is a big issue. We would like just not to give a solution, but humbly just give another point of view. We would like just to have your opinion at the really end. This is our goal. So let us pass to the remarks from the institution involved in this event. And Lynn from NYU, I'll pass the floor to you.
I'm Lynn Brown, Executive Director of the John Bradamus Center at NYU. And on behalf of NYU DC Dialogues, I'm delighted to welcome you to On the Move, a deep and moving exploration of the stories of migration told through the lens of art. Thanks as well to our partners, the University of Palermo, Department of Law, the Italian Cultural Society of DC, and Multivolti. The John Bradamus Center is a public policy center founded by a former member of the United States Congress, John Bradamus, who was also president of New York University. Much of the center's work in promoting education, arts, and culture reflect his, John Bradamus's, passions and interests. And for over two decades, he was in a position to advance those interests by actually putting laws on the books. And they remain to this day, including the National Endowment for the Arts and the National Endowment for the Humanities. Most recently, the Bradamus Center, much in keeping with today's event, sponsored a multi-part initiative entitled Women and Migrations, examining through many of the same artistic and cultural lenses this event does, the migratory experience of women and girls. So, in a word, the program today is about journeys. Journeys most often begun out of desperation and despair. Journeys, many of which are endured for years and carry great hardship with them. But journeys also that showcase the great human resilience within us all and the spirit of creativity. We hope you find inspiration in these stories and a better understanding of all of our fellow travelers. Enjoy.
Now is your turn, Carola.
Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. I'm Carola Mamberto. I'm a journalist and documentary filmmaker and acting board president of the Italian Cultural Society of Washington, D.C., or ICS. We are a nonprofit organization that's been around since 1953. Our mission is to promote the Italian language and Italian culture, which to us also means embracing the role that Italy has always played in shaping our understanding of some of the most pressing issues of our time, including human migration. That's because of Italy's geography, but also because of its history and heritage. Now, are we doing enough as countries, as institutions, as people, to give voice to the voices that are relevant in these conversations? That's an open question that I would like to leave with you. But I'll tell you this, today you will hear some of those voices loud and clear. ICS is very proud to support the remarkable artists and storytellers that you're about to meet. They are giving us something truly extraordinary today, which is an opportunity to experience their journey from their end, through their lens. The insight that you will gain this afternoon, raw, almost visceral, is invaluable. And it's something that we at the Italian Cultural Society really believe in, the power of those voices and the power of art as a way to channel those voices. So thank you to everyone who has worked very hard to put together this event, our hosts, New York University in Washington, D.C., the curators Renato Miracco and Mauro Testaverde, and the University of Palermo. You are all doing such important work, deepening our understanding of what lies on the other side of a often blurry and foggy lens. On behalf of ICS, thanks again so much and enjoy the event.
Aldo, it's your turn to talk about University of Palermo.
Hello, everybody. I'm Aldo Schiavello. My name is Aldo Schiavello. I am the dean of the law department at the University of Palermo. I wish to welcome all the participants to this event on the move alternative forms of journeys through an artistic lens. My colleagues and I are very pleased to co-organize this event with NYU DC Dialogues and Brademas Center and the Italian Cultural Society of Washington DC. And I would add, last but not least, even Multivolti, which is a very important, precious ethnical enterprise in Palermo. Palermo is the city where I was born and where now I live. And Palermo is not a city like any other in relation with the issue of migration. Since the 19th century, it was a point of departure for poor and disadvantaged people seeking a better life. And now it's a point of arrival, or I would say better, a transit point for migratory flows. Because of its history, Palermo is an extraordinary hospitable place for foreign people, and it could be considered a sort of sanctuary city, like some cities in the US, but in a general context of hostility for migrants. To change this context of hostility which is more important, the storytelling supporting it, art plays or could play a crucial role. For example, I am almost sure that all of you remember the picture of Alan Kurdi, the dead Syrian child with the face on the sand in a Turkish beach. This image, this photo changes, at least for a brief period, for a while, people's attitude towards migrants and even the reception policies of some European countries, for example, Germany, no? And I am a jurist, and I know very well that law is ineffective and law reforms are impossible if the background and surrounding conditions are not fruitful or at least good enough. For these reasons, I am convinced that art is a powerful tool to change our society, to modify our understanding of reality, and to build bridges and to break down walls. Sometimes to leave our country is the only way we have to survive, to save our lives, or to conclude, quoting Cormac McCarthy, to keep a little fire burning, however small, however hidden. And I thank you for your attention, and I hope you will appreciate the many events on the move. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Aldo. And let's move on. On the move, the first person artist we would like just to explore is Mohamed Keita. Mohamed was living in Ivory Coast, and he was 14 when he moved from Ivory Coast, and his journey was 3 years long in Mali, in Nigeria, in Libya. And then he finally went to Rome. Mohamed has a special relationship with photography. With Mauro, we were really stuck about his incredible view of photography, how is generosity about sharing. And now we have Mohammed with us.
Hello, Renato, per questa bellissima intervista.
Let me tell us about your relationship with photography. Was something totally unknown for you before?
La mia rapporto con la fotografia, diciamo che molto spesso il mio passato mi accompagna anche il viaggio della fotografia, insomma. Questo è il punto principale, in qualche modo, che mi dà la possibilità di vedere le cose un po' a modo mio, perché le esperienze vissute, quelli mi hanno insegnato a guardare il mondo in un'altra maniera. E anche ora ho detto che è vero, ho sofferto, ho passato i momenti veramente molto difficili, però queste difficoltà, in qualche modo, anche come persona, a me mi ha un po' trasformato, perché quando ero a casa, cioè, non è che avevo così tanto amichevole con le persone, non è che consideravo molto altri, insomma. Però uscendo e toccando il mondo reale con mano, questo mi ha dato la possibilità di amare ancora di più le persone, senza la diversità, per dire che questo del mio paese e quello è un altro paese, no. Giusto, mi ha fatto capire che ogni persona è di persona.
You will be able to attend the prestigious school of Rossellini in Rome. Let's just talk about this.
La mia fotografia tutto è partito qua in Italia. Prima la fotografia non è che mi piacevo tanto, in qui però a volte bisogna cercare sempre di andare avanti quella che ti capita nella vita, quindi trovandomi qua nella strada, avendo la possibilità di frequentare il centro civico, mi ha dato la possibilità di scoprire un po' il mondo della fotografia, perché da civico la persona che mi ha offerto il corso, lui mi ha conosciuto lì. Quindi frequentando il corso da Carlos, lui che mi ha dato mano veramente di capire bene, perché anche la fotografia è un po' come la scrittura, di capire bene come raccontare una cosa, no? Lì è stato veramente una persona essenziale, perché anche ora siamo sempre rimasti amici. È vero, anche sono da lui e su foto sono andato Roberto Rossellini, sempre era per aggiungere ancora l'esperienza che lui mi ha insegnato e andando anche in un'altra scuola. In qualche modo, anche se vedo quello che io faccio oggi, grazie a questo podio che mi è stato dato prima, che anche in qualche modo mi sento il dovere a farlo per altre persone, che sia qui in Italia, ma anche che sia altre parti, che sia l'Africa, e a dare la possibilità ai ragazzi di conoscere un po' la mia vissuta, la mia esperienza, ma nello stesso tempo di far capire anche che per fare le cose sempre abbiamo bisogno di altri. Si vede che io faccio questa cosa oggi, grazie a qualcuno che mi ha sostenuto il periodo in cui non avevo la possibilità. Anche io vi faccio questo, domani quando voi avrete la possibilità, cercate di farlo per altri.
What is really amazing that your personal experience you want to share not only with photography, ma you want to to be a founder of School of Photography. Can we share with us?
Sì, il workshop che sto facendo in Mali, anche in Kenya, quella di Mali ora è una scuola stabile, perché è 3 anni che va avanti, e la scuola non è un workshop, è una scuola fotografica, la base è la fotografia, però facciamo tanti altri lavori con la fotografia, ma la fotografia è la chiave, punto di incontro. Nello stesso modo come ho conosciuto questo amico che si chiama Johnny Muriri, che lavora con Action for Children in Kenya. E lui mi ha dato mano in Mali perché mi veniva a trovare quella parte di burocrazia, lui mi aiutava a fare quella perché lui è uno che conosce quell'ambito. Nello stesso tempo abbiamo pensato sarebbe bene di fare nello stesso tipo di scuola a fianco a quella che lui fa in Kenya. Quindi sono andato in Kenya due volte e abbiamo pianificato l'idea di fare una scuola stabile anche di fotografia lì e perché no in domani qui in Italia, altre parti. L'idea comunque è sempre basata sulla condivisione.
Who can attend your school? Which is the kind of kids, adults or who can attend your school?
Quando riguarda quella di Mali, la scelta iniziale ho sempre cercato di scegliere le persone, i ragazzi in cui che penso che hanno bisogno di una mano, quindi guardando un po' la famiglia, guardando un po' il contesto in cui che quella persona vive, perché spesso ci sono questo punto abbastanza difficile che a volte i genitori sono obbligati a mettere i loro figli nelle scuole private, però andando avanti non ce la fanno a sostenerlo, quindi i ragazzi lasciano la scuola alla metà, che è una cosa molto delicata, alcune diventa qualcosa altro, e perché cioè quella che piacevano non sono riuscito a farlo, insomma. Questo laboratorio che sto facendo, la idea è un po' a dare un po' di sostegno a questi ragazzi che possono studiare la fotografia, nello stesso tempo anche a dargli un podio per continuare la scuola. Questo è il punto che mi ha attirato di fare questa cosa. In qualche modo anche guardando la loro salute, guardando anche un po' a volte il contesto della loro famiglia, non è che è una cosa che mi obbligano di fare, però io lo faccio con piacere. Ci vedo che un ragazzo per fare imparare bene nella scuola mia, io devo cercare di capire questo ragazzo cosa ha bisogno. Non ha bisogno solo della macchina fotografica, però ha bisogno di essere mentalmente libero. Per dare questa libertà a quella persona, ci sono tanti altri lavori che si fa a fianco. Quella che io l'ho imparato alla scuola fotografica è nello stesso che parto con quella, però prendo molto sulla mia esperienza, perché anche quella che io faccio oggi, è vero, mi sono stato offerto molte cose, ma molte cose anche mi hanno mancato, che avevo bisogno, però non ho mai avuto quella possibilità. Quindi facendo questa cosa cerco di metterli un po' insieme, le cose che sia l'esperienza e che sia quella che ho imparato la fotografia, la scuola, insomma.
Mohamed, please, can you comment a little bit about the photo, the first photo? It's really amazing. I know that you exhibited in Biennale of Venice, at the Deputy Chamber in Rome, and in so many Italian cultural institutes around the world. It's really beautiful. Can you say a few words for our audience? Thank you.
Quella foto lì, quella è quando io sono arrivato qui in Italia, e quella zaino lì era l'unica cosa che avevo. E la borsa, no, la coperta che ci ho messo era quella che dormivo sopra, insomma, il cartone. Quindi il periodo in cui ho fatto quella foto, quella era la mia casa. In qualche modo, che mi anche, è la foto che mi ha permesso di studiare anche la fotografia, perché quella foto non era fatta per darlo a qualcuno o per metterlo un logo. Io avevo fatto giusto per il ricordo, come è passato abbastanza passaggi prima di arrivare in Italia, che non i ricordi visivi. Quindi avendo la possibilità di avere una macchina fotografica in mano, ho pensato che le condizioni in cui sto vivendo, avendo una immagine di questo in domani, mi servirebbe. Perché già guardando quella di Malta, che ho trascinato un anno dentro un campo che non uscivo di andare da nessuna parte, non ho nessuno ricordo. Quando sono partito da paese mio, non ho nessuno ricordo. E poi le persone in cui li ho conosciuto, che ci siamo persi di vista, non ho la loro immagine. Quindi tutto questo mi ha un po' tirato verso a fare quella immagine, insomma.
Thank you so much, Mohamed, to share your life, your experience, your feeling. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Let us move on another aspect, music, with Chris Obey and with this beautiful starting video. I will be on the move too. In the next minutes, I will move to another room. So don't be surprised. The honor, the pleasure, just to talk with Chris Obehi. Hi, Chris. How are you?
I am fine. I'm really, really happy to be like here, and I'm really, really where happy.
Where are you right now?
I'm in Palermo. Yeah, in Sicily.
Oh, wow! So, Chris Obehi is a songwriter from Nigeria. And in 2015, just to just summarize something for the audience, he arrived in Palermo after he crossed the Sahara Desert, Libya, Lampedusa, and then Palermo. Tell me about your relationship with music. So you always loved music, you always love harmony, or what is your relationship with music, or music was something unknown for you till then?
I would say that first of all, I have to start I'm really thanks to my family, being born up in a family, grown up in a family where they love music, and my mom loved singing the gospel songs, and
lovely.
Yeah, my dad is just a fan, number one fan of Bob Marley. You know, each evening, when he comes from his work, we put Bob Marley, "Could You Be Love?" You know, as a kid, growing up in that kind of vibration. And I was listening to these songs and everything. And that really helps me to through my hearing, listening to songs, now I can pick up the guitar and listen to song and I can play the notes. So that really helps me to connect me to the music. It all started when I was very young, my childhood experience. It all started then. Then I started to watch my uncle, because my uncle is really a pianist.
Very young, because you came to Palermo.
So.
You were 17, so it's really, really,
So that's where it all started, from home, back home, Nigeria.
Do you have a relationship with your parents now? They know about you?
My mom is my number one fan.
No doubt. No doubt at all. And they still live in Nigeria, or they want to come? Yeah, okay.
They're all in Nigeria. They're all in Nigeria right now. So yeah, my mom, my dad, my brothers. Yeah.
Okay. And you left Nigeria, if I may say, why?
I left Nigeria. The main reason why I left Nigeria was Nigeria. Let's say, from how it all started, Nigeria. It's not it's not a country that's really, to talk about the safety of the youth. The safety for the better future. I left Nigeria because, one, I was faced with a lot of a problem from security problems, and that I don't know if you hear about Boko Haram's bombing churches and bombing schools and that. So I wasn't seeing my country as a safe place for me, because I, right from when I was in Nigeria, I always have this dream, you know, I have this dream to like do music and become an artist, a big artist, and I have this vision of like, you know, go around the world and studying also music and, you know, stuff like that. But I wasn't really seeing it there. It's really a pity also, like now what's happening in Nigeria is really, really a pity. So I that was when I left Nigeria actually.
Yeah. And now you have a long plane, you have a disco, you have you launched just a new
Yeah.
2020, I understand you didn't have any concert around, you didn't that, but you have a really strong product. I was hearing that, and I hope that all the audience will buy your song. I really hope so, really.
Yeah. Let's say, like, thanks to, like, my producer and a lot of people who work with me. I find, like, these great people, special people here in Palermo. Like they really like do a collaboration with me, a great artist like Roy Pashi and the rest of them. And actually, I would say I'm really lucky to find my producer who really helped me with the disc. And now the disc has become a reality. But it was not really easy. I was thinking like this year to 2020 at first, I like, wow, coronavirus, it came to coronavirus. So should I release a song? Oh, no. I'm like, no, so I made up my mind, like, music can never be stopped, no matter what.
Right. You can travel with music, so absolutely. Yeah.
Nothing can stop
music. And you write the song, you are a songwriter, no? Isn't it?
Yeah.
And you have a surprise for us. Sorry, not surprise for me, because I know, but surprise for all the audience right now. And you have a surprise, and tell me about the background of these songs before you play.
I like most of these songs, like the ones I wrote when I came to Italy. I started writing songs actually, and these songs are not just like most songs I wrote is from my own experience actually. It was from my, like, take for instance, Non Siamo Pesci, in English, it's like we are not fishes. Non Siamo Pesci was really a really true, not just a story, but a real story from my own experience. The one I got from when I came to Lampedusa at first, where I was in a boat, when I rescued this baby right in the boat. So this story really, like, when we got to Lampedusa, I saw this baby and was like, the story itself touched me and really inspired me to write the song Non Siamo Pesci. And also other songs like Mama Africa. Mama Africa have to do with like where I come from, my land, also where I stand from, my roots, the beauty of Africa, and what Africa stands from. Also like to talk about Mr. Oga, have to talk about the abuse of power. Mr. Oga, so we have Without You, we also have Walaho. The one I dedicated with and to my mom was Walaho. So
stop, please. It's really interesting if you say, if you sing a little 30 second of Non Siamo Pesci, because your explication was so good and people can be intrigued by hearing your voice. And with Non Siamo Pesci, we are not fish.
Okay, all right. Vedo le case della gente diventare strada, perché l'odio e l'invidia disegnano la guerra. Non siamo pesci dentro il mare, non siamo pesci, ma siamo umani. Non siamo pesci dentro il mare, oh, non siamo pesci, ma siamo umani.
Oh, non siamo pesci dentro il mare, non siamo pesci, ma siamo umani. Oh, non siamo pesci dentro dentro il mare. Oh, non siamo pesci, ma siamo umani.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So moving. So moving, so beautiful. Really, really good. Thank you so much. And now going high. And now we are going ahead.
Okay.
Now it's turn to just to play. So all the audience will give you a big applause.
Okay. All right. In Sicilian, what they say is they say harmony when you want to say let's go, you know?
Let's go. Let's go.
Yeah.
Move on.
Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna do the song called Mama Africa.
Great.
This is a song I wrote when I came to Italy, in Palermo.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoy.
Thank you, Chris.
Amayo, amana, zamana. Hey, 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 hey.
Amayo, amana, zamana.
Hey, 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 hey.
So listen now. Listen to the children's voices. And listen now. Listen to the nation's calling. Do you remember when you came to our land with the ships and the bombs and the guns and the plagues and the chains and the cages? Cause we don't need to war just to show we're stronger, but we just need to love each other better. Simbiyakwe, Simbiyena, Simbiyakwe, Mama Africa. Simbiyakwe, Simbiyena, Simbiyakwe, Mama Africa. So listen now, listen to the children's voices, and listen now, listen to the nation's calling. Do you remember, taking to our land with the ships and the bombs and the guns, and the plagues and the chains and the cages? Cause we don't need to war just to show we're stronger, but we just need to love each other better. Simbiyakwe, Simbiyena, Simbiyakwe, Mama Africa. Simbiyakwe, Mama Africa.
Senegal, Gambia, Mali, Togo, Costa d'Avorio, South Africa, Nigeria.
Hey, 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 hey. La 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 la
Simbi Ena, Simbi Yahweh, Mama Africa. Hey.
Grazie mille. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you.
Thanks, thanks.
Thank you. Let's move on to another section of the event. We would like just to explore two documentaries. The first one is It Will Be Chaos by Filippo Piscopo and Lorena Luciano, Emmy Award winner in 2019. And the second one is Io Sono Qui, I Am Here. Let us see the first extract from It Will Be Chaos.
This is my cousin Binyam and his brother, Afolke. And this is my cousin Zenawi.
Does all of them, they are dead?
When we are nearer to Lampedusa, water is leaking. A spark happens. Boom. The boat flips 180 degrees. People on the upper stairs, they all fall to the sea. Most of them, they can't swim. Because it's full of people. I see some people, they are looking down to the sea, they are dead. We are crowded even underwater. Because 500 people on the same place. And hanging over and over. I said Binyam. I said Afwerki, Zenawi. I'm praying, saying, God, forgive me.
Ma quando l'abbiamo visto era mezzo miglio, roba di così, tre quarti di miglio.
Questo è il punto dove abbiamo preso quella gente. Ma ce n'era tante, noi abbiamo preso solo 18 vive e 2 morti. Però ne vedevamo tante in mare.
Ci facevamo capire il gesto. Più di così è la loro lingua che la capisce.
Subito salvagente, cime, tralli su, scappano dalla guerra, fanno lungo viaggio, rischiano anche la morte. Se ne poteva salvare di più, le salvavamo.
Lampedusa, coprendo Lampedusa, passa da Rosu.
Premesso che Lampedusa non arrivano clandestini? Non sono clandestini, parliamo di profughi e richiedenti asilo.
Donc l'économie ne baisse pas, ne chute pas à cause de l'image qui est donnée par les médias.
Sì, questa era la domanda, però insomma io la correggevo perché se poi lei deve raccontare al suo paese che da qui passano clandestini, vuol dire che non ha.
Elle corrige pour
dire non capisse lei, non. Diciamo,
elle dit c'est des réfugiés parce que c'est droit d'asile.
Non sono dei semplici sans-papiers quelli che passano da Lampedusa.
Réfugiés.
Sono réfugiés.
Okay.
Ma le parole sono importanti.
Hi Filippo.
Thank you for having me here.
Welcome. So Filippo, just to understand better, I want our audience to understand your process. you have a mental process and you have a shooting process. In the meantime, I know that you changed your plot. Why? And last but not least questions is, okay, when all everything started and why?
Okay, let's start from the original inception of the program, the film. It's, as I mentioned to you at the time, when we started to get the initial idea of the project, we were working on a work for hire documentary at the border between Arizona and the United States.
Oh, so here, United States. Well,
in the US. And as you know, we've been living here for almost 25 years now, living in Brooklyn, but we traveled all around the US for work. And in that case, we were working on a documentary following the stories of undocumented workers, undocumented migrants trying to cross into the United States from Mexico and coming from various Latin American countries. And at the same time we were working on that project, we started seeing on the news that many hundreds, if not thousands already of asylum seekers were starting to land with those boats full of people on the southern Italian shores and onto Lampedusa in particular. So it was this kind of, you know, realization, you know, we are Italians, Italian natives living in the US. We're working on a documentary on undocumented immigration into the US. And at the same time, we're seeing with a huge influx of newcomers and of, undocumented migrants and asylum seekers as well, landing on the Italian shore. So we said, we looked at each other, Lorraine and I, we said, we have to do something. We didn't know what in particular yet, because it was at the, you know, the initial stage, but we started to do research. We started to get in touch with several humanitarian organizations in the United Nations and FAO and Save the Children, who were working on site in Lampedusa to try to help these people. And we also started traveling to Lampedusa. We didn't take out our cameras yet. We just went. We went there. We started to explore the idea of the documentary. We started pre-production.
Tell me more about the two stories that you can see in the movie.
The first axis, let's say, is the one of the asylum seekers landing in Lampedusa, and we said yes, we want to follow the story. An exemplary story of an asylum seeker. And we found our guy. The meeting our guy was very important for us. We spoke to many survivors on October 3rd. And when we met our guy, the fact that he was so fluent in English and the fact that his story was so important and strong, and he went against all odds in order to get to Italy and to get to safety as well. We thought it was an exemplary story because, and at the same time, we had to establish a relationship of trust with him. Because it's not, you know, he was actually risking, because he was underground, he was undocumented in Italy. And as some people probably know, because of the European laws, he didn't want to stay in Italy as many asylum seekers who were with him, because there was no future in Italy for him. So he wanted to go to Northern Europe, to Sweden, and he needed to stay underground and undetected in Italy, because if they found him, they would have taken his fingerprints, put them in a database in Europe, and he would not have been able to go to anywhere else in Europe. So, and he actually burned his fingerprints at a certain point. That's what many asylum seekers do. In order not to be identified, he burned it with a lighter one night. So we followed his journey on one side, but at the same time, we thought you know, for having been in Lampedusa many times, speaking to everyone from the fishermen to the mayor to the Coast Guard officers, we understood that it was also important to tell the story of the local communities that were impacted by this crisis. Yeah. And that was the real conflict in the, that we identified in the film. A film with no conflicts, it's not an engaging one. You have to have a conflict. And that conflict was very important for us because, first of all, because it's our home country. And second of all, because many of those local communities were left alone to cope. We were editing this film when in 2015, in September, a dear colleague of ours who works for the United Nations in New York, she sends a colleague to us. And she says, listen, I have this colleague who is Italian. She's been all over the place working for UNHCR. And she's really caring about this Syrian family who's now in Turkey. They fled the bombs of Damascus. They're looking for safety in Europe, and they are in Turkey now. And she's looking for someone who could document their story. They're available to be filmed. So we meet with this lady here in New York, and you know, it's difficult because you are establishing the narrative of your film in a certain direction, and this storm comes from another side, and you say, should I include it? Should I not include it? Yeah. But we had to, Renato, because in 2015, the huge influx of refugees on a new path, instead of crossing the Mediterranean from Libya, they were actually crossing from the Middle East, getting to Turkey from the Middle East, from Syria and from, you know, the war theaters there. And then they were trying to get to either Germany or Northern Europe. And the story of the Syrian family it seemed exemplary to us because it was incredible. They were an upper middle class family. Husband, wife, four kids, 2 through 11, who are trying to look for safety in Italy. And the father actually says at a certain point, I was going out, I was leaving for work in the morning, and I didn't know if I would be able to come back home alive.
Yes.
Because a bomb could have killed me, you know, a sharpshooter could have killed him. So in that case also, we said to our friend's colleague, so let us think about it. We have to figure out if this is feasible. And she said, no, you have to leave tomorrow because these people, they're not going to wait for you. They're in here right now and they're leaving. They can't afford to waste any time. And when we died, we understood.
Yeah.
These people, they have a limited amount of money. If they stop in one place and wait too long, they run out of money and they get stuck in a place where they don't want to.
Well, I can listen to you for hours as we do every single time.
I talk too much also.
No, I would like just to have the privilege just to listen to the Lorena Luciano Emmy Award speech that she did.
Thank you very much for this incredible recognition. This award honors the tens of thousands of people who lost their lives at sea, trying to reach the European shores. But this award is also for the survivors who carry upon their shoulders the incredible emotional toll of all the suffering that they have witnessed. This award goes also to every single character in our documentary for their incredible pride and courage. Thank you very much. HBO for the unconditional support, Nancy Abram for trusting our vision, respecting our creative choice. And lastly, a note about our film team. The people who have worked on this film, we come from different countries, we have different nationalities, we speak different languages, we believe in different religions, we have different skin color, with different sexual orientation, but still we have come together because we believed in telling the right story. We shared energy, passion, enthusiasm, same values. And this award shows that choosing inclusion instead of building walls or closing ports is definitely a road to success. Thank you very much.
After this really moving speech by Lorena Luciano at the Emmy Award, let us move on a new documentary. Io sono qui, I'm here. Hi, Gabriele, are you there?
Hi.
Hi,
yes.
Fantastic, so it works.
I am here.
As the title of your movie, okay. Before we see just the extract of your movie, can you introduce in less than 15 seconds yourself?
Dun. Yes, sure. I'm Gabriele Gravagna. I am a filmmaker, an Italian filmmaker. I work for television and for cinema. And I love documentaries. Io sono qui is my first short documentary, and I'm so happy and glad that today we have the possibility to share this with New York City and Palermo, my city.
Thank you, Mattia. Thank you.
Tu ne peux pas imaginer. Avec les imaginations, tu ne peux pas savoir ce qui s'est passé. Pour raconter ça, c'est quelque chose qui va te donner beaucoup d'émotions. Si tu rappelles de ça, ça peut te faire pleurer et de savoir ce qui s'est passé là-bas. C'est quelque chose de pire.
Cet voyage, ça me rappelle beaucoup, beaucoup de choses. Ça me donne beaucoup de expériences de vivre. Et puis, j'ai eu beaucoup de difficultés aussi.
Tu ne fais pas ce voyage parce que tu as des plaisirs. Tu voulais seulement faire. Tu as un risque derrière toi. Et encore, tu affronteras un autre risque. Toutes les personnes que j'ai rencontrées, ce que j'ai parlé avec eux a des problèmes très graves, des risques de mort. J'aime mon pays, mais si ça devient des risques pour toi, risquer ta vie, sa vie, ça devient dangereux, et alors tu n'as pas d'autre solution et d'aller ailleurs.
Ma vie est changée. Une meilleure future ici en Italie. C'est ici que je vais rester.
Beautiful, this beautiful, really, this few minutes of your movie, Gabriele.
Thank you.
They will explore really another aspect of minors and undocumented minors coming to as an immigrant here. Why you are interested in that aspect? And because nobody were exploring that one, you have a personal relationship with the issue, or why? Tell me. Sorry.
I've been working as a filmmaker for TV, and I collaborate with NGOs also. And I have often documented with my images the landings of people on the move from Africa. I usually made close up on the faces of these people. And I was impressed of the eyes of these young women and men. So in my mind, I would know more about their stories. And often these images were used by television, and the media spoke of immigration. I don't like this word. Yeah. They talked about numbers, and in the worst cases, they spoke of an invasion.
So the other side of the medal, the other aspect.
Yes. Because the problem is generalized about this problem. It is an emergency. It's correct. It's an emergency, but we can't talk about numbers or data. We have people. We have a child.
People. We have to respect that one.
Yes. So for me, it was important listen. I'd like to listen the story. And the idea of the documentary is very simple, because it's based on three long interviews. For me, it was important stay with the voices of the three protagonists, Dean Magasuba and Omar, without any element, other elements. The interview is the center of the documentary.
Thank you, Gabriele, because now we have one of the protagonists on the other side. I don't know if Dean will be there. Dean, are you there? Hi. Dean, are you there?
Io sono qui.
Oh, you're still qui. You are here. Okay.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Sono qua.
Okay. Where are you? No, you sono qui, ma where are you? I know where you are, but I would like you to stay where you are.
Ringrazio tutti quanti, io sono qui oggi al nostro laboratorio, negozio, qui al centro storico di Palermo, a due passi di Piazza Rivoluzione, in via Aragona, mi trovo qui oggi. Abbiamo creato Giocherendan nel giugno 2017, è nato come un gruppo collettivo, che poi è diventato associazione per promozione sociale a febbraio 2018, e oggi abbiamo qui nel cuore di Palermo, questo della nostra città, che ormai dico che siamo palermitani perché dove vado in qualunque Orlando, posto.
Gianluca Orlando, sei palermitani.
Sì, no, siamo palermitani, anche come dice sempre il sindaco, quindi chi arriva a Palermo è palermitano direttamente, quindi non è questi problemi. Allora siamo qua, cosa facciamo come Giocherendan?
Yeah.
Allora noi abbiamo pensato di creare qualcosa di condivisione che unisce le persone, che mettono le persone per poterle integrare, e abbiamo pensato dei giochi cooperativi, come vedete qui dietro di me. Questi sono per esempio dei dadi. Nel sacchetto ci sono 6 cubi, ci sono immagini siciliane, africane in generale, che uno, la prima persona butta il dado, comincia la storia, c'era una volta. La seconda persona tira il suo dado, continua la storia, quindi sono storia unica che ognuno di noi mette un pezzo.
Tu vendi solo giocattoli, giochi, o sì, vendi anche altre cose?
No, allora noi non facciamo solamente dei giochi, facciamo anche delle mascherine, per esempio questa da qua, vedete? Questo è la mascherina, anche con realizzato direttamente anche con la camicia. Realizziamo...
I want.
Ok, realizziamo anche le camicie a misura, pantaloni, qualunque cosa che uno vuole. Abbiamo qua, diciamo, varie stoffe africane, 100% cotone. Qui questo è il lato giochi. Qui siamo nelle sezioni, diciamo, delle camicie, wow. Come vedete. Qui dietro ci sono le stoffe. Uno può scegliere la misura, qualunque cosa che vuole, perché queste sono molto, diciamo, hanno molte funzioni, quindi lo puoi usare su quello che ti piace. Quindi abbiamo dei ragazzi che hanno dei talenti diversi, basta solo farli vedere che oggetto vuoi realizzato, subito ti dico che ti mettono al lavoro e in pochi, diciamo, in due giorni, un giorno, poche ore ti dicono sono pronti, e quindi è questo. Qui, ecco qua, qui sono versioni donna, ci sono anche delle sciarpe. In questo momento stiamo realizzando varie cose per regali di Natale, e quindi qui è il nostro logo, che è Giocherenda. Quindi queste là, ora vi faccio vedere la parte delle macchine. Vedete qua, ci sono le macchine da cucire, tutto questo di mattina i ragazzi si saranno impegnati tutta la mattina per produrre tutto quello che vedete qui dentro. Quindi non è che andiamo noi a comprare le cose pronte, no, tutte le cose che sono qui, ma una cosa importante che ho dimenticato di dirvi, perché noi abbiamo fatto tutti questi lavori che vedete, anche ci sono dei portacomputer, le mascherine, ultimamente la gente usano moltissimo queste mascherine, che c'è anche la possibilità di mettere il filtro dentro, ma la cosa che volevo dirvi è che noi perché abbiamo creato tutte queste cose? Uno è per stare vicino alla gente, condividere qualcosa, anche noi partecipare, fare qualcosa per migliorare queste integrazioni. Comunque c'è integrazione a Palermo, ma in più noi abbiamo pensato il lavoro, non si deve dire che io devo solamente andare via o devo prendere il mio curriculum per andare a cercare lavoro. Il lavoro lo creiamo noi. Anche noi, se dobbiamo avere l'idea, mettere le nostre idee in pratica, così potremo trovare lavoro per noi stessi e anche offrire a qualcun altro lavoro. E questa è l'idea, quindi, di non mettere nella nostra testa il lavoro qualcuno me lo deve dare. Ma perché io non devo dare lavoro a qualcuno?
Grazie mille, grazie. Veramente stiamo in contatto, we will be in touch, thank you so much. We just heard the Dean interview, and I would like just to put the last question. This is your first documentary as an author and director, and you collaborate with so many documentary, movie, and for television. I would like just to have your feeling. What is your feeling after you did this? What is your feeling in the next months, in the next 3 months? What will remain in your soul?
Wow.
It's a tricky question. I know it's a tricky question.
It's a wonderful question, because after a film like this, your life is richer, it's correct, because in my life now I have a little piece of Dean, Magasuba, and Omar, and it is a huge thing for me. Change the way to see the world, and we are very happy to share this film with schools in Italy. A lot of young people have seen the movie. Every time was an experience, because the young are more curious and have more feelings than the adults.
Is a new key in your life. Is a really a new key.
Yes.
A new
yes.
Point of view. This is exactly what I feel as an audience. I would like just to explore with you what is your feeling as a maker. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Sorry for this intimate question.
I'm very happy. Thank you for the question.
Thank you so much, Gabriele. Good luck.
Thank you.
Let us move on to another aspect activism. And today we have the opportunity to interview Francesco Memoli, who is the founder of Saving Humans US, who is a sister organization of Mediterranea Saving Humans.
Mare così straordinario, bellissimo, è un mare, crudele, un mare che non perdona, un mare, ma sai che cosa c'è che è più crudele? Quel mare di indifferenza invece che oggi stiamo assistendo. Non vengono più considerate persone, quando invece sono dei bambini, delle donne, degli uomini, delle persone, non sono numeri, sono persone, persone come noi, uguali, forse di colore diverso, ma il colore io dico che è un vestito, sotto quel vestito siamo tutti uguali.
Loro, quando hanno visto una nave all'orizzonte, si erano spaventati e avevano pensato di nuovo alla Guardia Costiera Libica e quindi si erano sdraiati tutti nel gommone tentando di non farsi vedere. Ecco, quindi noi li abbiamo visti in realtà a cavallo con tutti i maschi intorno al gommone, le donne dentro e poi sono sboccati come funghi questi 26 bambini che erano tenuti all'interno.
Il primo atto nella situazione di rispetto che dicevamo è restituire dignità a questi corpi che non ce l'hanno. Ma non solo perché sono venuti in queste condizioni, perché vengono da storie in cui sono corpi da abusare e da usare.
Sono nate poi tantissime attività fra di noi, con gli ospiti.
Diciamo, attività di che genere?
Attività di disegno, ad esempio, con tante ragazze della Mare Ionio, splendide, un'attività di studio della lingua, quindi lavagna fatta sul... E quindi una settimana di scuola, penso la prima settimana di lingua italiana per loro, ecco, quindi.
Mais la séparation serait un peu brusque. Mais nous avons besoin de la séparation. Mais on vous portera toujours dans notre cœur.
Questi ragazzi, queste ragazze, nonostante tutte le loro tragedie, comunque hanno lottato per sopravvivere, comunque volevano arrivare in Italia, comunque hanno un sogno da realizzare. E la forza di questo sogno è incredibile. Quindi penso che noi dobbiamo imparare da loro, dobbiamo imparare a sognare di nuovo, sognare qualcosa, mi viene da dire, di bello.
Francesco, nice to meet you.
Good afternoon, how are you?
Good afternoon, good morning, good evening. We don't know which is the time right now in the other parts of Italy, United States, wherever. Francesco, was really, the video was amazing. Was really moving. As we said before, you are just the president of Saving Humans in US, who is connected with Mediterranean Saving Humans. Why we need two entities? Because one entity is in Europe and one entity is in the United States. Tell me about just the connection between the two sister organizations.
Mediterranea actually started as the platform of the civil society.
Okay.
Was the gathering of several entities, several groups, several movements from any different circumstance and past and experience. So in Italy already, Mediterranean is not just one thing, is the unity of several efforts to the south. And then Mediterranean expanded because the sense of the need of, you know, doing something for this situation in the central Mediterranean is so big that people in Spain from Barcelona and in Germany from Berlin and other countries in Europe, they started to have their own Mediterranean Spain, Mediterranean Berlin, Mediterranean Barcelona, Mediterranean in France. And
it's all around Mediterranean Sea. Yeah.
And that's how we also joined the same effort. Because if you think about what is going on right now, Renato, in the central Mediterranean, we see the news that come out every day of hundreds of migrants drowning at sea before our eyes. They cannot even leave the coast of Libya for just a few miles. They're already sinking the boat. What is happening right now? We don't understand the magnitude of what's going on. I think it's just in 20, 30 years what happened.
Yeah.
So right now, the immediate need is to save people that is drowning.
Yeah. But you are focusing on the Mediterranean all over the world. So this is somebody will stay in, I want to say Mexico or wherever, in Cuba. Can you rescue him, her?
So that's exactly the point.
Okay, sorry.
Why Saving Humans USA has been created. We have realized that what is happening in the central Mediterranean is no different from what is happening at the border between the United States and Mexico. It's not different than any other border where people are trying to cross to get to a better life. Migration is not a problem. Migration is a consequence of several other problems. And those problems, either it's war, it's climate change, it's poverty, it's hunger. Those problems are not just in one single location. So Saving Humans USA wants to be a bridge between what we're doing in the Central Mediterranean, what other groups are doing here. So sometimes people is asking me, well, you know, why you want to help from the United States the people that is drowning in the Mediterranean? Don't you think it's better or easier for you to help the people crossing trying to cross the desert and get to the United States? And I say, there are many groups already established here that are doing that incredibly important job. What we're trying to do is we're raising funds for Mediterranean right now, because that's where it's really needed immediately.
But
also joining the effort of groups here, creating a bridge, talking to each other, because the more we talk to each other, the more we interchange experience, the more we learn on how to
improve
the situation.
This is for the audience. If you would like just to give a donation, you can see now the logo and the how you can make a donation to this institution. Thank you. Say thank you, Francesco. It's really important what you are doing. It's really, really great.
Thank you very much.
Let us move on to another aspect of this event. Maybe when we are talking about migration, immigration, we never think about that one heart can express all the feeling. And I'm talking about dance. dance can express the pain, the struggling of immigration. And here we have Mimmo Mikolis, who is a choreographer based in Washington, D.C. He's working with the Washington Ballet, and he did an incredible, beautiful piece of dance on this issue. Hi Mimmo, how are you?
Hi Renato, hi everyone. Thanks Renato, I'm very happy to be here today.
Okay, I saw your video and I wrote down some questions that I really would like just to put. And I wrote down because I say I don't have to miss this, I don't have to miss this. So I know that you are you were in Lampedusa, and the fact that you were in Lampedusa inspired you to do this choreography.
Besides being my voice, I think dance has the power to touch your heart. Without words, without writing, the complexity and difficulty of understanding the meaning of movement, make sure that the message touches you directly. It does not abandon you. Being a contemporary artist, I always felt the responsibility to speak about important topics, but I never felt directly, I never find myself in the situation of impossibility to help someone on a boat that was just a few meters from me.
I understand. Can you give us just a glimpse, an idea about the process, the creative process to create, to perform a ballet?
I always start the process by talking with the dancers, explaining my vision and telling them that we have the responsibility to speak about what is happening in the world now.
Who are the dancers? Seems to me very, very young. And how you communicate with them, and which is their feeling doing this.
The dancers in Deep Blue are the trainees at the Washington Ballet. So they are very young and they just move away from their places to reach from all around the world to reach Washington. So they understand what it means to adapt to a new culture, to a new place. So when I start the process and I explain them, there were so many moments in which they ask me questions because they don't really understand what it means to cross the ocean to reach a dream.
Tell me more about the music. The music is so beautiful, so, and combines really well with the movement. When you start from the music, from the movement, which is the musician?
I'm a big fan of Ezio Bosso, and it happened to hear this piece that is called On the First Star of the Night. And I saw directly the choreography. I felt the waves, I felt the emptiness of the ocean. I felt the dark around me, and I see the journey, and in the dark, your only destination are the stars.
Tell me more about the name of the piece.
I call the choreography Deep Blue, because the ocean is deep and blue. It gives the idea of the enormous distance, because the sea is so big and sometimes cruel, holds the dreams of so many men, women, and children who couldn't make it.
And tell me more about the movement.
The first movements that came to my mind were inspired by the work, something you can propose when you arrive in a new land. So I saw a group of women who show how they can sew, and a simple job that you can that you know how to do, and that allows you to start working even without knowing how to communicate. I also thought about the position of the Statue of Liberty. She's not standing still, she's moving forward. In the choreography, you always feel the instability. The waves move you constantly. The waves that decide if you will arrive at your destination, and the waves that push you forward to a new life.
Please share with us your idea, your process with movement and meaning. Tell me more.
There is a moment in which first three dancers, then two girls, try to support each other to face the trouble. You know, you have been through so much before that you don't know whether to trust the others or not. Their travels start days, months, or years crossing countries and deserts. They met so many good and bad people. When they arrive to cross the sea, they are totally different from when they left home. It is a war of emotions. In that moment, you have two options: fear and hope at the same time. The conflicting emotions, the loneliness. You can probably count on someone around you, you don't know them. All in the same boat, alone in the middle of nothing. There were some moments very, very emotional. For example, there is a moment in which they simulate the water, and that calm water became a storm. And there is a moment in which they look up and they hope that someone will come to save them.
How does your piece end?
In the last part, the music had a part that described exactly the voice, almost breathless, which in the instability of the waves expressed the tiredness, the desire to see someone who arrived to save you. The fear of going back, the fear of never arriving, the waves, the sway of the boat, the storm. I presented this choreography with two different casts. One has in the center a man, the other a woman. One of them, only one, will reach the destination.
Thank you so much, Mimo. Thank you, thank you. See you soon, I hope in Washington.
Thank you so much, Renato. It was an honor to be in this beautiful cast of artists today. Thanks, bye.
What I would like just to say now, we heard artist experience, director experience. Now it's time for you to share your experience and to put some questions to Alessandra from University of Palermo, and who will be in the Multivolti Center. And we would really would like just to hear your voice. And at the end, we'll comment. Thank you.